Good evening and welcome. I'm Jennifer Dorian, the CEO of Public Broadcasting Atlanta, and we're so glad that you've come to join us for our discussion on athletes and activism, inspired by Ken Burns' new documentary, Muhammad Ali. And speaking of champions, we want to send a big thank you out to all our sustainers. We appreciate you so much. And to our funders like WIDA and Bank of America, who make conversations like this possible. Let's take a look at a special message from Bank of America. We appreciate their support. And now it is my pleasure to introduce our moderator for tonight's panel and our WABE All-Star, Rose Scott.
Thank you, Jennifer. Well, good evening and welcome everyone. And on behalf of Public Broadcasting Atlanta, let me just say thank you for taking the time as we discuss and reflect about a man called, well, a titan of boxing and the 20th century, a civil rights advocate, and of course, simply the greatest, Muhammad Ali. You know, when Ali died in June of 2016, more than just the sports world mourned his passing. It had been three decades since his last professional fight. Muhammad Ali's death was immediately transformed into what was his legacy, and that was of a champion inside the ring and out. And tonight I am honored because two things. One, I get to talk about Muhammad Ali, and I'm joined by an amazing, amazing group of people as we examine this intersection of sports and activism. Plus, we get to share some clips from the new PBS documentary, Muhammad Ali, from Ken Burns. Of course, that premieres on our PBS station, ATL PBA, Sunday, September 19th at 8 p.m. And if you're wondering what you're going to get, here's a preview.
Do you know your dad is the baddest man in the world?
Without any further introduction, Muhammad Ali.
He's young, he's handsome.
They know it.
Never talk about who's gonna stop me. Well, ain't nobody gonna stop me.
I'm showing the world that you can stay yourself and get respect from the world.
He's 22 years old. And he's standing up to the whole establishment.
Wait till you see Muhammad Ali.
Muhammad Ali starts Sunday, September 19th at 8, 7 Central, only on PBS.
Ah, rumble, young man, rumble. We'll be glad to show you some excerpts tonight. Plus, we invite all of you watching via Facebook or YouTube or StreamYard or whatever you're watching to give us your input as well. But let's first welcome our guest. First up, he's someone I know personally, and he's the only person I know personally that's been on a Wheaties box. He's a track and field icon, Edwin Moses, an Olympic gold medalist in 1976 and 1984. Three World Cup titles, two World Championships. He broke the world record four times as a 400-meter hurdler. And look, he remained undefeated in 122 consecutive races, spanning about 9 years, 9 months, and 9 days. And by the way, yes, he's a Morehouse man. He attended Morehouse College on an academic scholarship. And I am so honored to have him here because for the past 20 years, he's been the chairman of the Lawrence Sport for Good Foundation. And this is an organization that's all about using sports' positive influence as a powerful social tool. Please welcome Edwin Moses. And then also, I'm very honored to have joining us is an award-winning sports journalist. Always love to talk sports. Terrence Moore, with more than four decades as a journalist. You name it, well, Terrence has covered it. The Super Bowl, World Series, Final Fours, prize fights. We'll talk about that. NBA final games and everything in between. He's currently a national sports columnist for Forbes.com. He's also part of a weekly Sunday television sports show in Atlanta. And he's a frequent sports contributor to MSNBC and NFL Films. Terrence Moore joins us as well. Also from the Morehouse College, student athlete Sean Johnson. He's a junior communications major with a minor in journalism. I'm very happy about that. He's a Bonner Scholar and student athlete on the Morehouse football team. He also serves as president of the Morehouse Student Athlete Advisory Committee, which focuses on service, engagement, and advocacy. And last but certainly not least, bringing in Furlong, Charity Toussaint, who's director of external affairs at the Center for Healing and Justice Through Sport. with over 15 years of experience as an activist and using sports as a catalyst for social change. And the mission of the center is real simple: to ensure that more young people have access to sports experiences that are youth-oriented, healing-centered, inclusive, and they work to address the issues of systemic injustice. Can y'all think of a better panel? I cannot. Welcome to you all.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you.
Let's get right to it, because Furlong, I'm going to start with you. When I say that name, Muhammad Ali, the greatest, what can you say about this individual?
You know, I think one of the most important things about Muhammad Ali is that he called himself an activist. I think, you know, a lot of us go through life and think about all these different titles for ourselves, right? Mother, father, sister, brother, journalist, athlete, right? And he went out of his way to let people know that that's who he was, and that his athletic prowess was a small part of his identity, but who he was truly a man of the people, for his people. And I think that when I hear his name, it reminds me of what I call myself an activist first before I call myself any other title.
All right, Terrence Moore, what about you?
So many things, but I'll tell you, as you can see, I've got this poster behind me right here. And I've had this poster since I was 18 years old, and I'm a little bit older than 18 right now, which tells you how far back I go with Muhammad Ali. He was just so awesome. I mean, you look at all the great athletes in the history of the world. We got one right here with us here. When it comes to what he did as far as in the ring and outside of the ring, it's unparalleled. It goes beyond anything that you can possibly imagine that one human being could do. Because he was so much more than sports. And even as much as people think how great he was, he was even greater than that.
Oh, wow. Sean, what about you?
When I hear Muhammad Ali, I immediately think more than an athlete. I feel like he set the standard for athletes who want to step outside of their respective platforms to really strive to be more than an athlete. As an athlete myself, I've always sought out to, show other areas that I can excel in. And Muhammad Ali did just that. And growing up in an era where athletes were seen as just athletes, his action showed that he denied that narrative. And that's what I think of when I hear Muhammad Ali.
All right. And Edwin Moses, what about you?
I remember the days, and Terrence may as well, the fights, the only way you could hear them was basically on the radio. You could see them at some of the theaters, the people were at the fights. But Muhammad Ali represents a time when the word activist was a verb and not an adjective. Mm-hmm. And it's a very different time now. What he did, he put his body on the line, he put everything that he had on the line. And to me, that's what real activism is. There's a distinct difference between activist being a verb and an adjective, a descriptor.
Edwin, let me stay with you, because I want you to be able to tell this story very early on in this conversation. And I want the audience to hear from you about the day Muhammad Ali came to Morehouse College and what you were doing.
There's all of my colleagues remember it. I remember I was in, a psychology class, facing out towards where the new football field is. And all of a sudden, it sounded like a riot was going on outside. You could hear screaming, sort of like a pep rally before the football game, or it sounded like tailgate was going on. And one guy at the back of the room jumped up and looked out the window and said, "Look, it's Muhammad Ali." And everyone just packed up their books and just split from class that day. And there's some fantastic pictures of him surrounded by students on the campus in front of the old cell hall. So that was a fantastic day. Then I had a chance to meet him several times in life. He was a guest at the Laureus, some of our events over in Europe, in Paris. I remember meeting him. And by the way, Farlone was one of my colleagues at Laureus. He was one of our first hires here in Atlanta. So we go back a long way in terms of sports and activism. But he was a great guy. You had to listen to the fight on the radio. Your mom and dad probably wouldn't let you go to the theater. and it wasn't on TV back then. So,
Terrence, I want to talk a little bit about Muhammad Ali inside the ring for a moment. I had this conversation earlier on Closer Look with a guest. At 22 years of age, taking out the great bruiser, Sonny Liston, and not only predicting a win, backed it up, and then was still talking after he won. How did he shake up the sports world?
Yeah, I mean, that was rather amazing. That was a little bit even before my time, Rose. But we all know about that story because, I mean, that was just legendary because, I mean, Sonny Liston was considered invincible. But coming up to my era that I remember very clearly, and that's what Edwin was alluding to, is that, you know, these games that, or these fights you will listen to on the radio. And the epitome of that was his trilogy with Joe Frazier. I mean, those things were wars. You know, 71, the first fight at Madison Square Garden, and then you had the one in 74, also in Madison Square Garden. He lost the first one to Joe Frazier, won the second one. That's what this poster is about, the second one at Madison Square Garden, Thriller in Manila in 74. And I tell you, the fight game is nowhere near what it used to be. But back then, I mean, these were just huge events, you know, just bigger than life. And then you just multiply that by 1,000 when it came to Muhammad Ali. And the Muhammad Ali and the Joe Frazier things just put boxing at a whole different level. And I'm sure we can get into this too, because it became more than just boxing, because, you know, it became which side were you on, Joe Frazier or Muhammad Ali? And it wasn't as far as a boxing thing. It went further than that from a social aspect. And I'll just tell you this real quick thing, Alliance. In 1971, that first fight at Madison Square Garden, I'm in high school in Cincinnati, and I can remember very clearly, I mean, it was just like, it was a huge racial thing, not only just between white and black, but between black and black. You know, if you said that you were for Joe Frazier, you were considered an Uncle Tom, okay? If you said you were for Muhammad Ali, you were considered to be beyond Malcolm X. You know, you're a Malcolm XXX. So it was like you had to take a choice. So there was all besides just what he was doing in the ring.
Furlong, when we look at this young then Cassius Clay and later became Muhammad Ali, can you imagine someone now 22 years of age with this? Let's be really clear. There were two at that time. If you were the fastest man in the world or if you were the heavyweight champion of the world, those were two sports positions that everyone looked up to. 22 years of age and someone like Cassius Clay then coming out, I'm changing my name. I'm joining the Nation of Islam, which the American nation had its own perception of.
Right.
Someone this brash, this brawn, and being black, coming out after becoming the heavyweight champion of the world, and now is taking these social justice, social injustice stances at 22 years of age.
Yeah. I think that there's something to say about someone who believes in themselves so much, right, that they really aren't even aware of the consequences of what it would be to decide to go against the establishment, to decide to speak out on during a time where, honestly, you know, the maiming and the punishment that the Black community was going through at that point in time, you know, everybody was told to keep their mouths shut. You know, I think that there is something to speak though about like the youthfulness, right? I think it's the youth who really are the ones who push progress forward because of that fiery desire to not allow the things that happen in life when you become an older person to just lie down and take it, right? I think that there's something to his youthfulness that really pushed him to be that brash and to be that audacious, right? But I also think it's a very special characteristic of who he was as a person, as an individual.
Sean, when you think about Muhammad Ali at the age of 22, and Sean, may I ask, how old are you?
20.
20, just 2 years older. And thinking about taking that stance in that climate, this is during the 60s, which I know you've studied and you've researched, to take a stance at that young of age, already supplanting yourself. In some people's eyes, they love you. And in some others, they hate you. Can you imagine that at that age?
Man, I really, really can't even imagine what that experience would be like. I think that for Muhammad Ali, his actions kind of show a lot about his upbringing, and his parents and his supporters, his support system. Who he has at home and in his corner has generally influenced him to want to take that solo route and stand up for his beliefs despite what others may say. And I feel like that has just simply influenced this current generation of athletes who are doing that and are deciding to take advantage of their platforms and just overall stick with what their ideas and their visions and their morals are, despite what anyone else has to say.
And think about this, you all, and for the audience out there, when Muhammad Ali, refusing to go to war, gave up a lot, gave up the title, stripped of the title, lost money. I'm going to show you a clip now. This is Ali. He's found guilty of refusing the draft, and he's prepared to go to jail or to even die for his beliefs. Let's take a listen.
Two weeks later, an all-white Houston jury found Ali guilty of refusing the draft. The judge, ignoring the more lenient recommendation of the prosecutor, sentenced him to the maximum, 5 years in prison and a $10,000 fine. And he would have to surrender his passport. Ali's lawyers immediately filed an appeal.
An appeal.
Prepared to go all the way to the Supreme Court if necessary. A process that could take years. Ali remained free. Without his title or a license to box. He fully expected that he would one day go to jail for his beliefs.
We who are followers of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, the religion of Islam, we believe in obeying the laws of the land. We are taught to obey the laws of the land as long as it don't conflict with our religious beliefs.
Will you go into service as such?
This would be 1,000% against the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, the religion of Islam, and the Holy Quran, the holy book that we believe in. This will all be denouncing and defying everything that I stand for.
This would mean, of course, that you stand the chance of going to jail as a result of not going into service.
Well, whatever the punishment, whatever the persecution is for standing up for my religious beliefs, even if it means facing machine gun fire that day, I will face it before denouncing Elijah Muhammad and the religion of Islam. I'm ready to die.
When I think about him saying, if they want to put me before a firing squad tomorrow, I'm ready to die before I abandon my religion. That's it. You can't teach that kind of thing in lectures, in books. That kind of thing has to be modeled. And models turn into traditions. And traditions provide people with the mechanical memory to do the right thing. That's what Muhammad Ali represented in that moment. I mean, anybody now faced with a major decision in which the right way is clear and the wrong way is clear, but the consequences are dire, now they have a model that they can fall back on psychologically, emotionally, spiritually. That's what Muhammad Ali represented in that moment. And that, to me, that moment will live on forever.
Wow. I want to remind the audience that please feel free to add a comment or a question. If you're watching via our virtual conversation, you can put your question or comment in the comment section. And of course, if you're watching via the other platforms, go ahead and use the comment section. Edwin Moses, let me start with you. Muhammad Ali, adamant, poised, measured in his stance, never wavering, and willing to give up, and did give up so much.
And as Farlone alluded to, a lot of Black people were afraid to be what they used to call a race man back then, which my father was. And I remember in the in West Dayton, in basically the Black downtown of West Dayton, my dad used to do his banking, and the Fruit of Islam guys were out there all the time, My dad always bought the newspaper, Muhammad Speaks. We had a bunch of newspapers and magazines at the house. We had Ebony, Jet, U.S. News and World Report. I think Newsweek, and Muhammad Speaks all the time. And my mom being a reading teacher, we read it. But being that young at that time, and I was drafted in 1974, so I almost had to deal with the same thing. It was weighing on my mind what had happened to Muhammad Ali, because I, fortunately, the end of the war happened and I didn't have to go to Vietnam, but I was definitely poised to go. But it was said that Muhammad Ali had the gall to behave that way. And a lot of Black people in the community did not even agree with him. They thought he was too brash, too aggressive, and he was seen as a radical, especially when he went with the Nation of Islam. So, I mean, it's something. I still remember, you know, driving in my dad's 55 Chrysler, going down there and seeing on this at like 7, 8, 9, 10 years old. So it was a time, as Terrence said, it was a time when we lived in a very different environment. There was, Arthur Ashe was probably around. There were no Black football coaches. There might have been one or two professional basketball, because Wilt Chamberlain and Bill Russell would coach, but there were no Black referees, very few Black journalists. It was just a completely different world. And so for him to take that stand was just very avant-garde, very aggressive. And even the Black community was afraid, you know, to side with Muhammad Ali. I mean, we loved him, everyone loved him, and we rooted for him. But in certain public situations, you wouldn't talk about your support for a guy like Muhammad Ali or Malcolm X and all these other gentlemen that really put their bodies on the line.
Agreement, and by all means, panelists, jump in there. It's a conversation. It's not formal.
I want to ask something here. This is, I want to take one of my pet peeves. And it's just a piggybacks on what Edwin just said and what we just saw in that clip. And I've written about this before, and I've said this before. I am just totally disgusted by this revisionist history now about Muhammad Ali. Okay, right now, everybody loves Muhammad Ali. Okay, white folks, Black folks. But Edwin is exactly right. Okay, as the old saying goes, I'm old enough to remember when the majority of the people hated Muhammad Ali. I'm talking about hate. That's the right word. There was none of these people talking about, oh, how courageous he is and then how he stands for his principles. No. He was strongly disliked. George Foreman talks about this. George Foreman said, this is about 4 or 5 years ago, that no one wanted to be associated with Muhammad Ali. This is a side that nobody talks about here. Mm-hmm. So what happened? What happened was, and this happens an awful lot when it comes to us as Black people, once you are perceived as not being a threat anymore, then people love you. Okay. Like a feeble guy or whatever. In their minds, it was fashionable to be a Muhammad Ali lover. But no, that's not what I remember way back during the day. And that's something that needs to really be talked about more than it's talked about, because it's rarely talked about, because it hurts too much.
Right. To your point, Terrence, though, I think, you know, this is why it's so important to know your history, right? And yes, don't, like, because this keeps happening to us, right? I'm thinking about Mahmoud, you know, at the NBA. I'm thinking about Colin Kaepernick, right? Like, at some point, we have to recognize that there's a cycle here, there's a pattern, right? And picking up on the pattern, you know, to say something like, I'm ready to die, right? Like that kind of, like, you know, belief in yourself, that kind of idea that like my values and principles mean more to me than you liking who I am. And I don't care if you like me, this is what I'm standing on. That, you know, that's just something people don't respect until it's too late, right? The guy said, you know, he was right. We were wrong.
And keep it in mind, and Sean, I'll let you chime in on this too. Keep it in mind, this is during the civil rights movement. This is also at a time where we're not far from some of the riots taking place in cities throughout the nation, folks standing up. So whether you were part of the civil rights movement that was more nonviolent and you subscribe to that ideology, or maybe you were starting to get in line with the Black Panthers or what have you, people were beginning to have their own, shape their own ideology, their own set of values about how Black people during this time need to stand up for themselves. And you have a young man like Muhammad Ali saying, I'm not going to go fight for you when you don't even respect me here in this nation. Sean, reflect on that.
Yeah, I think Muhammad is just a true inspiration to everyone who was living through that era, like you mentioned, civil rights movement. They needed that figure who had the platform and, you know, did what others thought they could do, but never took the step. So I believe that Muhammad really just, you know, influenced a lot of the younger kids under him. And I'm sure he influenced many, many adults who are older than him that, you know, just didn't have that courage and felt afraid. But, you know, his willingness to persevere despite the cameras and the reporters, it really shows how fierce of an individual he was, not just physically, but as well mentally.
And before we get to another clip, and I want to bring Edwin, I want to bring something into to conversation if you can reflect on too, because as and you too, Terrence, the young folks in the nation at that time in the United States, how do you, was there any sort of allegiance toward whether, well, I kind of like him as when he was just a boxer, or he should just stick to boxing, or wow, look at this guy standing up. What was the feeling as youth, as young folks, as young boys? What was going through your mind? Terrence, I'll start with you.
Yeah, I mean, just going back to what I said before, when I got this poster at 18 or even before that. I mean, growing up, I mean, I'm just talking about from a Black perspective. So what I'm going to say from a Black perspective, you can imagine what it was like from a white perspective. But again, you had to choose. I mean, if you were pro, and again, it was like a Joe Frazier, Muhammad Ali type of thing. If you were pro Joe Frazier or anti Muhammad Ali, so to speak, and I'm just talking about from a Black perspective, you were labeled an Uncle Tom. I mean, there was no in between. If you're pro Muhammad Ali, then the connotation was you're a radical. Okay, so people can kind of tell where you stood just in the Black community, just on that thought right there. Okay, and
let me ask you this: what did your parents? Let me ask you this, Terrence. I want to stop you. What did your parents think? What was Muhammad Ali's perception in your household?
Yeah.
And now that's a good question because I grew up in, and I'll make this quick. I grew up in an interesting household. I grew up in a household of Jackie Robinsons. Okay, I grew up in the Midwest. My dad started out as a janitor at AT&T in South Bend, Indiana. He became the first Black supervisor in the history of AT&T. He and his best friends helped integrate the golf courses in the state of Indiana. My brother, Daryl, my youngest brother, I'm the oldest, he was the first Black baseball player in the history of the University of Wisconsin. I can go on and on. So that's the kind of household that I came up in. So we were Muhammad Ali people, put it that way, all right? But there were other people that we were associated with, relatives and neighbors, who weren't that way. So, and you can go to probably every family, and be interested to see what Edwin has to say about this. Families were split, friends were split, neighborhoods were split. And that's what, again, not to belabor the point, that's why for those of us who lived through that period, you watch some of the stuff, you listen to some of the stuff, and you go like, really? I mean, really? I mean, that's the way I grew up.
I feel you, Edwin.
I grew up in a family, my mom and dad were both educators, and they were fighting to get us to be able to get on the bus to go to the schools on the other side of town, to get the same kind of books that they had on the other side of town for the three Black high schools and the other schools. They were fighting for that. Everybody I knew was a Muhammad Ali fan, all the kids that I grew up. In fact, if you couldn't do a good semblance of an Ali shuffle, you might get beat up on the way home. Everyone was Muhammad Ali in my neighborhood. And all the young kids, we used to just shadow box all the time and throw in the Ali shuffle. So everyone that I knew was Muhammad Ali.
Well, in my
can I ask a quick question here? Because this is interesting. Edwin, now I grew up in a predominantly white school system a lot. So I'm thinking that maybe that's from my background. Edwin, did you grow up in a more of a Black environment? And I'm just trying to figure out whether that could be part of the reason there's some more Muhammad Ali.
I lived in West Dayton. I went to an all Black elementary school. And then in 1969, that was the year in which the school board and my mom and dad helped make that happen. decided that we could ride the city bus, and they made it open enrollment. So I was in there the first year of open enrollment. And then I went to a school that was predominantly white, and where most of the Jewish kids went to school. So I went to a mixed high school. I look back today, it was so diverse. I mean, it's as diverse as you can get for 1960s and early 70s. So I grew up in high school in that kind of environment. But my house was surrounded by three sides by low-income housing. In fact, I was born in a low-income housing project in Joy Homes in Dayton, Ohio, when my mom and dad first came there, because dad couldn't get a job with a master's degree. He was working at the post office and doing construction because they wouldn't hire him as a substitute teacher. So my dad and mom were both pretty radical and made a lot happen. So I grew up kind of in both worlds, and then went to HBCU. Yeah.
Well, in my household, it was all about, it was Jackie Robinson, it was Althea Gibson, it was Muhammad Ali. I'll tell that right now. And it was Chuck Berry, because my dad was a musician. So go figure, all those folks. But those are pictures I remember seeing in my house growing up. And I remember my father educating me more about the younger Muhammad Ali, because when I started getting in boxing, I was a Sugar Ray Leonard fan. You know, I was a Larry Holmes fan because he could jab. My father was like, no, don't you forget about it. Let me tell you about this young fellow when he was Cassius Clay. Mm-hmm. So that's where history comes in. I think Furlan was talking about, and so was Sean, when we talk about knowing your history and educating yourself about folks who've come before you and the sacrifices that have been made. I want to play another clip now, because this is actually talking about other folks talking about Ali's evolution into a person bigger, and I do mean bigger, than boxing.
Ali, late in life, talked about this tallying angel, he called it, that there was an angel up there who counted all the good things you did in life and all the bad things you did in life. And if you had more bad things than good things, you were going to hell. And he had a very vivid impression of what hell meant. And he acknowledged that he had a lot of negative marks, that the tallying angel was not going to be happy with the way he had treated women in particular.
30 years after Ali first faced Joe Frazier, a reporter asked him about their long-running feud. "I called him a lot of names that I shouldn't have called him," Ali admitted. "I apologize for that. I like Joe Frazier. Me and him was a good show." Frazier never forgave Ali. Later, he expressed sorrow at having abandoned Malcolm X. "Turning my back on Malcolm was one of the mistakes that I regret most in my life," he wrote. "I wished I'd been able to tell Malcolm I was sorry, that he was right about so many things."
Daddy evolved, he became better. And Daddy said that, "I'm bigger than boxing." That meant boxing was this much his evolution into the person he is today is way bigger than him just boxing. And I think he knew that. And he carried it with him. His love. And he gave it to every single person he met. And I think that's beautiful.
As the 20th century came to an end, Newsweek, Time, and Sports Illustrated all named him Athlete of the Century. In the days after the terrorist attacks of September 11th, 2001, American Muslims were the victims of hate crimes simply because of their faith. "I am a Muslim. I am an American," Ali responded. "If the culprits are Muslim, they have twisted the teachings of Islam. Whoever performed the terrorist attacks does not represent Islam. God is not behind assassins."
What I hope is that Muhammad Ali will be a constant reminder to America of just how thoroughly American a believing, practicing, sincerely committed Muslim can be. whatever one's background is, Ali belongs to America, all of us. And I think that he belongs to all of us because he affected all of us. And I hope that that's part of the legacy that he will leave, that America won't forget Ali as this American Muslim, with equal emphasis on American Muslim.
On November 9th, 2005, President George W. Bush presented Ali with the Presidential Medal of Freedom, the highest civilian honor in the United States. That same year, the Muhammad Ali Center, a museum dedicated to his life and legacy, opened in Louisville.
Muhammad Ali was an activist who fought to reach us a certain way and to move America in a certain way, and to move individuals in a certain way. I'm going to take this path. I believe that I'm right. And even if I'm not right, I'm still me. And to be able to follow that and to know that there was going to be an enormous price to pay for that and to have that be generational, to have that live on beyond you is extremely valuable. Everything that he did couldn't be undone.
Harlan, if Parkinson disease doesn't slow Muhammad Ali in movement, doesn't slow him as an orator, does some of the conversation we're having even today, has that changed at all through the lens of some others? And I think Terrence alluded to that a little bit earlier. I just want to get your thoughts on that.
Yeah, you know, it's such a great question, Rose. You always ask the best questions. You know, I think one of the things that, like, when I hear you ask me that, I want to remind everyone, I'm not sure if everybody's familiar with the Cleveland Summit, you know, the 50th year anniversary of that gathering of Jim Brown bringing together Bill Russell and all of these other athletes to support Muhammad Ali. After his decision not to go to Vietnam. I'm calling back on the Cleveland Summit because I think that, you know, you are only as good as the people around you. And so, yeah, that kind of experience of Parkinson's and that kind of, like, the kind of trauma that this man endured throughout his life, I think when you think about the Black men that surrounded Muhammad Ali, I'm not shocked at the level of bravery and courage, you know, courage that he had. I think that I call back, you know, this reminds me a little bit of the relationship that LeBron, Dwayne Wade, Carmelo Anthony, Chris Paul have. And I think that, you know, their status is a direct reflection of their relationship. You know, I call upon that kind of idea that I'm my brother's keeper. I think that that has a huge effect on who he was as a person. I think people tend to forget that, like, he wasn't doing this alone, right? He had a group of Black men who came to his support. And I know that they were at his side at other times in his life. But I really want to call upon that spirit of my brother's keeper. And I'd love to hear what others think about that, because I don't think that that's as common these days, that I want to go out of my way to use my name, my reputation to support my brother, right? Because I think that he needs to be supported. I think that that's something that needs to be acknowledged as part of even that clip.
Well, let's dig into that for a second. Let's talk about brotherhood and sisterhood, because last year we saw the WNBA take the lead in terms of being not just vocal. Can you imagine a team wearing shirts that say vote for the other guy that's running against your owner? You know, think of how long Colin Kaepernick, how long he's been out of football. Think of the stance that Venus and Serena did. And I know there are some different optics surrounding all of those examples. Terrence and Edwin and Sean, you get into this too, because I want to talk about then this brotherhood and sisterhood of activism in sports. And there's actually a question in our comment section. Do we see that? Are we starting to see more of this now because of last year with everything surrounding George Floyd? Edwin, I'll let you take it. Of course.
I think we're seeing it in a tremendous way, especially when it comes to the type of financial assets and capital that's moving around, especially among these black athletes buying companies. For example, Shaq just bought Reebok a couple of weeks ago, and I know he has interest in other franchises, and as well as doing those commercials. So film companies, I think LeBron has a film company. I think, what's his name? Just opened another film house where they're doing documentaries and everything. So they're doing all kinds of things. So a lot of capital is moving around. When I first heard about the women from the Atlanta, basketball team and the problems that they were having with this woman that they were able to overturn, I said to myself, I'm hoping that these women have the audacity to be able to turn this mother out, to be honest with you, and make her go away, which they did. And now one of the main women who Parlone and I hosted at one of our events, she's a part owner of the team.
Renee Montgomery.
Things have definitely changed. Just on a sidebar, Muhammad Ali won the gold medal in 1960 as a light heavyweight. Joe Frazier won at heavyweight in 64. George Foreman won in 68. But a lot of people don't know that Muhammad Ali actually had a track club based out in L.A. I moved out in 78, but he was the first one to hire me as a television commentator for the indoor Muhammad Ali track meet in 1977. And I didn't have to run. In fact, I got paid more than everyone who was running because he wanted me to do the commentary. And it was on ABC TV, I think. He wanted me to do the commentary. So I was out of the guest. So he gave me a break and was always proud to be in Olympia. But a lot of people don't know that fact.
Terrence and Sean, you can jump in too. And then this may not be fair, but we talk about people want to always say, well, Michael Jordan should have been like Ali because he was at that level. And I know Michael Jordan's not here to defend himself. But I'm just saying, when we have these icons, these titans in sports, and we expect them to speak out, and we expect them to do this, that, and the third, and everyone expected MJ to be like Muhammad Ali. Was that fair, Terrence?
Yes, it was. It was fair. Then this is one of my pet things here. I just think it's totally disgusting what Michael Jordan did not do in the 1990s. And I'm going to piggyback into the latter part of this. This is why I'm just so proud of what's happening now post George Floyd. I just hope it just is sustained, because we had this dead period in there. I mean, we had the Muhammad Ali era, the Bill Russell, the Arthur Ashe, and what have you. Then we had that dead period that started with Michael Jordan, where he said that Republicans buy sneakers too. And the other guy I'm not leaving out of here is Charles Barkley, okay? When he gets on and he says, and this all takes place in the early 1990s, I am not a role model. Well, I'll tell you, we're all role models, number one, and the more visibility you have, the more responsibility you have to be a role model, particularly in the black community. So we went through this period from the early 1990s until LeBron. And I don't think as much publicity as LeBron gets for his activism, I don't think he gets enough. Because even before Colin Kaepernick in 2016, there was LeBron James in 2012 with Trayvon Martin. Okay, and we should never forget that. So this is another one of these periods, if it's sustained, that could be very close to what took place during that Jackie Robinson, Muhammad Ali era. But then going back to what you said about Michael Jordan, yes, people should never forget that period when he could have done more and didn't do it.
Can I just say really quickly, though, forgive me, but this reminds me, and I'm such a sports activism geek, so this is a really random fact, but Jack Johnson, the first black heavyweight, right? He was also, you know, someone that folks wanted or expected more of, right? But Jack Johnson just wanted to be a baller. He wanted to wear his fur coat. He wanted to be with his white girlfriend, and he wanted to make as much money as possible, right? I think that there is a level of like just Jack Johnson existing in his like, I just want to be the best is revolutionary in itself. I think that Michael Jordan being who he was and the sneaker deal and everything that was Michael Jordan is revolutionary in itself. To me, he may not have wanted that responsibility. And I agree with you, Terrence, that he had it because he had that visibility. But either way, him just existing was revolutionary as an athlete in that space and that time, making the deals that he was making, you know? So just random. But I think Jack Johnson is equivalent to Michael Jordan in that way, where it's like, I'm just trying to ball out.
Let me add this real quick thing here, and I don't want to dominate here. I was very close to Hank Aaron. And I was closer to Hank Aaron than any other journalist, a very good friend of mine, Hank Aaron. And I'll tell you this quick story here. Hank Aaron's idol was Jackie Robinson. When Jackie Robinson died in October of 1972, Hank Aaron went to Willie Mays and to Ernie Banks and said, and for people who may not know, these are legendary baseball players, okay, Hall of Famers. Hank Aaron, legendary Hall of Famer too. Hank Aaron went to those two and said, look, now that Jackie Robinson has died, it's up to us to take up the mantle and do what Jackie would have done as far as speaking out. Jackie was very outspoken. And Hank told me that Willie Mays and Ernie Banks said, we're not going to do it because we don't want to ruin our image. And Hank Aaron said, you know what? I'm going to do it myself. And I tell that story because that just tells you why the Hank Aarons and the Muhammad Ali's are at a certain level. Because, yes, they could have sat back, just like Michael Jordan said, well, you know, hey, I'm Hank Aaron, I'm Ernie Banks, I'm Willie Mays, I'm whomever, and do whatever. But they're thinking of the larger good. And those are truly great people, at least in my estimation.
Sean, let me ask you this. Who are your favorite sports folks right now that you love to watch, that you might even look up to? Who are they?
Well, I'm a huge fan of LeBron James, his work on and off the court when it comes to the NBA. Following him, another athlete who's closer to my age, Jaylen Brown. I've huge amount of respect for Jaylen Brown, and just his age and his poise, you know, still, you know, separating himself from other guys who are at his age, who are just, you know, getting accustomed to the life of an NBA player. Instead, his foot has always been, you know, on the gas to make a difference in his community. And I really respect him for his efforts as an NBA player. So those are, you know, two of my favorite players to watch.
Well, Jaylen Brown plays for the Celtics, correct?
Correct.
Now, let me ask you this. Do you expect those folks that you mentioned, do you expect them to be out in front if there's something that deals with social justice or injustice or racial injustice? You expect them to be out front, to be verbal, to be in the mix? Is that what you expect of them?
Well, yes, simply because of the way they carry themselves and because of what they've accomplished, like I said, on and off the court, I feel like they're pretty deep within what's going on. They're pretty aware of all of the issues that are going on within the Black community and just in the U.S. in general. So I feel like once players kind of, you know, express that these are matters they're passionate about and these are things that they, you know, really just want to help out in, I really do expect those guys to come forward when issues do come up.
You know, time sometimes can be kind to us, and sometimes it just reminds us that with time, you know, whatever our journey, whatever that path is, that's the road we shall take. I want to play a clip now. I think that we all remember. I think, Terrence, you might have been downtown. I know I was. It's from 1996.
In 1996, the Olympic Committee, planning the Summer Games in Atlanta, asked Muhammad Ali to light the torch at the opening ceremonies. At first, Ali declined. He didn't want to be seen shaking and stumbling on that stage. But his friend Howard Bingham convinced him, "This is the thing where the world is saying, thank you for all that you've done over your life," Bingham told him. "There will be 3 billion people watching." The plans were kept secret.
Do you recognize her? Janet Evans. Considered the greatest female distance swimmer of all time.
And it was planned very brilliantly. I mean, people really thought the swimmer, Janet Evans, was going to be the person who was going to light that torch. But instead, out of nowhere comes Muhammad Ali.
I'll take the long road.
You hadn't really seen him in a while. You knew he was sick, and when you would see him, he was clearly showing the effects of the illness. But he hadn't been seen that much, and then here he is in this big prominent moment. And he's holding that torch and he's shaking. And man, I'm about to cry now. It was hard to watch because you don't want to see your guy like that. You don't want to see that. But you saw it.
He was defenseless now. He can't hurt us anymore. You know, he can't make us mad anymore. Because now the game that we ask him to play to entertain us has left him looking like this. Now we feel some sympathy, if not guilt. We see him shaking, trembling up there. The most beautiful moving, most beautiful athlete in motion you've ever seen. And now he can't hold the torch. You know, so we feel guilt and we feel sympathy. We want to hug him. We want to embrace him. We want to ask his forgiveness. You know, everything, for every reason that we disliked him, now we love him. You know, because he was right.
It was striking to see this evolution, not in Ali, but in us. It just struck me so amazingly to watch Ali riding this torch, people weeping. It's amazing. And you cast back not so many years before, and some huge amount of the country thought this guy was the Antichrist, where they chose to hate him, where they made him a foil to the other guy that they like better. And it's entirely possible that human beings are capable of learning something. I'll take
the
long
road. Yeah, yeah. The outpouring of love caught Ali by surprise. Parkinson's robs you of confidence, Lonnie told a reporter. Now he knows the public will love him and accept him, no matter what he has.
I had just moved to Atlanta in the summer of 1996, trying to start my career as a journalist. I sold t-shirts downtown at the Candler Building. I did some freelance work covering women's judo and track and field. And Terrence, I was down there. I was way down at the bottom. Nobody, none of the journalists, we knew nothing. And I was just in awe. And there were tears. I looked around, I saw people wiping tears away from their eyes. And I think there was something that was said in that clip about how people view that. And for some it was, well, he can no longer hurt us because that's how he was viewed. But to us, it was our hero in a different light. A hero who couldn't throw the punches anymore. A hero who couldn't do the rope-a-dope anymore. But he was still here. He was still here. Terrence?
Yeah, Rose, this was a personal thing for me because when I saw that, and I was there when that took place, I immediately thought back to 10 years, almost to the day, okay? And that's where this poster comes in again. This poster I've had since I was 18 years old. I knew one of the Ali's publicists, and I said, hey, whenever Ali comes to town, I want to do a one-on-one interview with him. And so it's June 18th, 1986. You'll see in a minute why I remember the date. I get a call, and this publicist said, hey, come on down to the Marriott here in downtown Atlanta, and you can have a one-on-one with Muhammad Ali. I thought the guy was kidding me. And I said, can I bring my poster too? He said, sure, bring it. I want him to sign. So I bring the poster down, and the guy that told me about Ali, you know, set this thing up, he's coming down the hallway and he said, hey, he's waiting for you in his room. The door's open. I got to go run some errands. So I go into this hotel room, the old downtown Marriott, and there's a curtain there. And I can hear Muhammad Ali kind of mumbling on the other side of the curtain. And I'm just trying to think to myself, what is this, you know, what is this moment going to be like? And I've interviewed all these famous people, but never Muhammad Ali. So he opens the curtain and he's standing there totally naked. And he says, who are you? And I couldn't speak at that point. He closes the curtain back, gets dressed, comes back out. He sees this poster, okay? And he just looks at it. And he's shaking. And remember, this is 1986. This is a decade before that moment. The Parkinson's was already starting then, on June 18th, 1986. And it took him, he signs this to Terry, love Muhammad Ali, June 18th, 1986. That's when I first saw personally how bad this was. But having said that, even with that, in that state, and he couldn't speak very well, you still could feel the charisma of Muhammad Ali. He even did a magic trick for me out there about this much. He was off the ground. That's my story. But the thing is, it just showed me again that moment in 86, 1996, that in spite of everything, this guy very well could have been the most charismatic, not just athlete, but person certainly in the top five on the face of the earth ever. Mm.
Edwin Moses, that moment, 1996, Atlanta Olympics.
I was there. I was one of the, what is it, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 people that brought in the American flag, and we walked around the stadium with the flag. And so I was very close, right at the bottom of the stage. And so I remember
Well, we'll get Edwin back in just a moment, telling a great story. Furlong, for you, that moment.
Yeah, you know, when I'm hearing him say, you know, the sacrifice that that sport, the toll that that sport took on his body, to be a man of such strength and stature, and to give so much of yourself to a game, that at the end of it all, that's how you end up. You know, I think we have to do some reevaluating as a people. I think we have to take a moment to recognize what we are truly sacrificing and why, right? And I think in Muhammad Ali's case, the price was great. But because of his sacrifices, we are able to experience lots of privileges now, right? But for these other athletes out here who are like getting concussions and going into obscurity, right? For folks who are like playing these sports where they're really hurting their bodies, I just wonder at what price. And if you're not going to use your voice, but you're going to use your body, you know, take a look at what happened to Muhammad Ali and what was lost by his friends, by his family, you know, because of that great price.
Mm. Robbed by injustice and then robbed by disease later. Sean Johnson, when you see that clip of Muhammad Ali and in the clips you've been watching earlier and then what you've seen before, what goes through your mind?
Well, it kind of just, you know, piggybacking on what Ms. Toussaint said, it is time for reevaluation, you know. Looking at our athletes, we're not just entertainers. You know, we're more than just entertainers. And I think that everyone needs to have that awareness that these athletes are people as well. So when it comes time for them to voice their opinions and their feelings of, you know, ongoing issues that might be real strong issues, you know, we still have to hold a strong level of respect for them. And it's sad to see that Muhammad Ali was gaining respect when he was in one of his lowest moments. But, you know, better late than never. But moving forward, we do have to kind of end that pattern.
You know, you all might remember, at least Furlong, Edwin and Terrence, that fight against Larry Holmes. I think I was maybe 9 or 10 years old. I cried. I don't think Ali even threw 2 punches. Did he, Terrence?
That was so unfortunate. I mean, it was like you want your heroes to go out, you know, bigger than life, you know, and there's so many people and so many boxers that went out the way Muhammad Ali went out. But again, the positive is, for a guy to go out like that in a pitiful state, he was able to recover quicker than anybody can just imagine in that situation. I mean, it didn't affect him as much as it would have some other people because he was Muhammad Ali.
Yeah. Time now to get to some questions and comments. And by the way, folks, feel free to chime in here, add your question or comment. Here's one. It says, we often do not support those who boldly push the message. 50 years later, what has changed? The influencers of today do not seem to be as principled and willing to risk career, title, and even life in much the same way as Ali. Do we see that? I mean, we know what Colin Kaepernick risked and lost, but he's kind of like a man on his own out there. Furlong, let's take that. Because this is what you all do. This is part of your mission.
Yeah, you know, it's interesting. You know, I think one of the most important parts of what we're going to be doing at the Center for Healing and Justice through Sport is really training coaches, people who have direct access to the next generation, on understanding the true effects of trauma in the mind and in the body. And when I think about this question on, like, you know, 50 years later, what has changed? The truth is that, like, the trauma has not only increased, but it's also being ignored. And so it's hard to speak about, you know, influences of today and people not being as principled when, you know, our rights are being literally chipped away at every second, right? So every moment that we're moving towards justice and peace, there is another group out there who is focused on making sure that they repeal all of those things back, right? And so the backlash that continues to persist every time we move forward in social justice, in a place of peace, right? There's a group that's being forgotten. And we have to get to a place where we have to really address that group at one point, right? The group that's really responsible for the backlash, that really has a problem with, you know, everyone having everything that they need to have a peaceful and healthy life. We need to figure out what's going on with those folks and address the reason why they think that these opportunities for folks to live their full and best and healthy lives need to be taken away, right? But I think it's a lot to put on influencers. It's a lot to put on athletes when, you know, there are leaders in charge who are responsible for maiming and harming communities at whole. And I don't think that that's fair to judge them for that.
Anyone else want to chime in on that? Is it fair to put all of this on influencers? Go ahead, Sean.
So going into the athletes and risking their career and all the luxuries of their lifestyle, I feel that you kind of do have to look at the psychology of things. The mental aspect of athletes, some may have that fear of being singled out and not having that full support. And I feel, you know, many athletes are, you know, hoping that there can be this continuation of this wave of support from all teammates and leagues across the board, where one's rights or morals or how they're pushing their opinion isn't just to the point where they're alone. And I feel that if we continue, you know, to show our support and, you know, athletes as a collective unit, you know, come together to make change and advocate for change, that it'll allow for more people to not have to think so much about the risk, but instead, you know, the belief.
Yeah, that's good.
Okay. Edwin, what do you think?
I agree specifically with what Farlone said. It's a responsibility, and at the same time, everyone is not up to it. I can tell you from experience that after I became Olympic champion in 1976 and then began to get politically involved with the United States Olympic Committee and originated the out of competition drug testing programs. I mean, I felt a lot of pressure and I didn't have a lot of people backing me up. Certainly there weren't a lot of African Americans in the highest echelons of any sporting organization to be able to give me cover, but people were always willing to say, oh, you're doing a great job, keep it up. But there was very few people that were willing to block and tackle and protect me. So I've seen it from both ways. And at some point, and there's a lot of athletes that do get to that point where their performance and what they've done on the field really transcends the sport. And then at that point, should you wish you can do other things if you would like to, and everyone's not up to it. I can tell you that right now. There's a lot of people that are going to protect every egg in their basket and not take any risk. And I think some of them regret it. I hear from people all the time to say, I wish I would have done something 20 years ago when the time was right. I just didn't feel that I could make that move back then. So
Go ahead.
I was finished.
No, I was going to say, parents, let's move from the athletes to the league. Because remember now, it wasn't that long ago when NFL, now they started playing the Black National Anthem and all kinds of stuff. I mean, what responsibility do the sports leagues have here then? Because they're starting to shift a little bit.
They've got none because it's all about money with them, okay? And we can just bang our heads and say that they should do this, they should do that. No, it's all about money. And the only reason the National Football League, for instance, started going the other way when it came to Colin Kaepernick and all of a sudden pretended that they were on board was because of money, okay? Because they saw that they were losing dollars from sponsorships or from even black fans. And as we know here in Atlanta, Georgia, you know, if it weren't for black fans, there wouldn't be any support of the Atlanta Falcons at all, which is a bad club, but black folks support them no matter what, that team. So, yeah, it's all financial. So, yeah, we could say that they should, but that's not going to happen. But one other quick thing I want to add to what was just said before, and I thought about this years ago, and I had to catch myself on this, and it piggybacks to something I said earlier. The reason a Hank Aaron, the reason a Jackie Robinson, the reason a Muhammad Ali, they're so special is because there's only a few of them who are willing to go out there and do what they do. Think about it. When we talk about these people, these activists, we're always talking about the same handful of people in the past and even in the present. I mean, once you get beyond LeBron James and a few other people here, the people who consistently have been out there, even now, is only a handful of people. So you know, a lot of it is, and I'm not sure whether this is right, wrong, or what have you. I'm just saying that it just is. The way life is, the majority of the people don't have the capacity to do what, you know, what we're talking about here, to get out and be outspoken and be out there and out front, which is why these other people are so special, because they're able to do that and they're equipped to do that. They're God-given to do that.
Yeah, but I just want to say really quickly, that's why the documentary is important, right? Because it humanizes him and gives us a chance to see that it is possible for little old me to possibly just do something, right? Even in my own little corner and my own little chair with my family, with my friends, I can represent the values that Muhammad Ali has. And to me, that's why just even telling the story is valuable, because we can duplicate it. We can learn from it.
As we begin to wrap up, and Terrence, did you call the Falcons bad?
It rolls up in a mistake. They're not bad. They're brutal.
Stop.
They're worse than bad.
This is one game, man. Come on.
You told all about that one game. But anyway, let's move on.
Terrence Moore has not changed, ladies and gentlemen, in 40 years. As we wrap up, and I'm going to start with you, Terrence. You know, we opened this conversation, and I asked you all to reflect on what was the legacy of Muhammad Ali. And then as we wrap up here, I'm going to ask you to reflect on how now the next 50 years, what you hope his legacy will be in terms of its influence on today's athletes as it relates to activism. You got it, Terrence.
I hope his legacy is complete. And what I mean by complete, everything that we've talked about here, that's just get away from you know, oh, geez, what a great guy he was, blah, 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 principal guy, and so on. So get to the bad stuff, too. And the stuff that we just talked about earlier about how there were people who hated him, black and white. That's all part of the story. Because for us to go forward, we're going to have to understand the good, the bad, and the ugly, not only with Muhammad Ali, but with all of our heroes and all of us, because that's going to help us personally. One quick thing along those lines that I got to mention this. You talk about that flame thing, all right? One of the unfortunate things, I was there when this happened. Joe Frazier was asked what he thought about Muhammad Ali lighting the flame, and Joe Frazier's comment was, I wish I was up there so I can throw him into the flame. That was very unfortunate, but it just told you about the bitterness that lasts for all those years, because whereas Muhammad Ali was turned into a sort of a deity as time went on, Joe Frazier, who was actually a very good person, very principled person, he just kind of got lost in the shuffle, and he never got over that, and that bitterness was always there. And that's the unfortunate thing we don't need in the black community. We like to have everybody pulling in the same direction. And unfortunately, that was something that just tells you kind of what can happen, even when you got that great guy on that one side and the guy that's kind of like considered lower on the other side.
Well, and real quickly for our audience that may not know this, because Frazier was insulted, he was called, I mean, look.
Yes.
You are an Ali fan, everything that Ali said, I mean, Frazier was called some of the lowest, most vile, disgusting references, terminology out there as it related to his intellect, how, you know, the perception of his intellect, all of that. So he carried that, and it's understandable. You know, it's understandable. In terms of the question, the next 50 years and Ali's legacy on today's athletes.
Yeah, I actually hope that, you know, to one of Terrence's points, I hope that, like, we can really give folks the space to learn in public, give folks the space to apologize, to grow and learn. You know, in the work that happens at the center, obviously the focus is on young people and the youth, but the truth is that without focusing on the healing and transformation that needs to happen for adults, coaches, teachers, parents, the youth have no future if we as people aren't growing and learning as the adults who need to support them and give them the tools and the resources they need to be the best they can. And the only way we can do that is if we humble ourselves and apologize, if we humble ourselves and grow and learn to be better. As they said in the documentary, that's what happened. Muhammad Ali grew and became a better person. And I hope that in the next 50 years, we focus on that. We learn in public and we give folks grace and we don't leave anybody behind in the process.
Sean, 50 years from now, when you're sitting in my spot reflecting with all your wisdom and knowledge?
Well, you know, similarly to what Mr. Sean said, I hope that you know, there's a wave of increase of individuals who are, you know, becoming those activists. I feel like everything is in place for, you know, other student athletes my age and younger to use those platforms and that wide reach through social media to reach everyone. So I feel like through the next 50 years, it's only a matter of time before we really take advantage of our resources to actually, you know, become activists.
All right. And Edwin Moses, I'll give you the last word.
I hope I'm around 50 years from now, Rose. That would be a good thing. I'll be trying to moonwalk. But but I think there's a new generation of black athlete now. As I mentioned before, the kind of access to capital that they have, the kind of moves that they're making in finance, I think is going to shift, hopefully, a lot of the youth away from thinking that the only way that they can make money and be involved in culture and business is trying to make some beats in their basement or do something like that. But they'll follow the lead of these guys of owning companies, employing people, being massive employers, and then having influence in and around the community, so that when we're talking about voting rights, abortion, things of that nature, they'll be able to step up with not only their presence and the ability to verbalize, but also their financial capital and being able to put people in positions so that there is more influence for the community.
All right, Edwin Moses, Terrence Moore, Barlone Toussaint, Sean Johnson, an incredible conversation. thank you all for being part of this as we talk about the not only just the legacy, but the man himself, Muhammad Ali. And thank you all for joining us out there in the virtual world. Maybe next time we can do it in person, but we are living in extraordinary times. So thank you all for taking the time. Programs like this are so important. Conversations like this are so important. And it's because of your support out there in the community that we really appreciate it. Thank you all. Everyone have a great, great evening. And remember now, September 19th, Ken Burns' documentary, Muhammad Ali, begins a four-part series. So make sure you tune in. Thank you all.